Okay, so what interests me as an artist is the whole idea of transformations. And life, the cosmos, is in constant flux all the time. So, you know, changes are happening all the time. I think that, you know, the focus that I have chosen in my practice is how we can actually change reality, transform reality, or at least our perception of reality by rewriting the mythic underpinnings that, you know, forms the foundations of society, culture, our lives. I did not arrive at this topic right off the bat. I mean, just as I did not become an artist right after school. I think that when I first started practicing art, you know, the issue that I was focused on was the idea of memories and how memories are constructs, and that they are, you know, dynamic, they're changing all the time. And much as we sometimes think that we want our memories to stay the same forever, that is actually an illusion. And you know, we are always changing our memories, or always editing, re-editing it. And so, you know, the whole idea of change, you know, or accepting change, comes from, started with this series. And if we really think about it, you know, memories are just codifications of our experiences. You know, even our genes are a type of memory. And, you know, everything that we have, you know, it's who we are as people. The basis of it is because of the persistence of memory. But yet, at the same time, memory is also fractured. And we from these fractured pieces, we kind of like string together a narrative of our life. And for some of us, we kind of like elevate this narrative to a mythology. And that is how I kind of like was slowly aging towards, you know, the whole idea of re-looking at personal mythologies. What I came across was actually the philosophical aspect of Taoism and how it talks about life is how life is always in flux, you know, how the universe is always in flux, and it all ties in with, you know, my experiences of life up to that point. And, you know, it also, in a way, I kind of like see some resonance with, you know, current trends in quantum physics, in mathematics and science, you know, and how, you know, chaos theory and all that, you know, I was kind of astounded by how, you know, Taoism in a way sort of foresaw a lot of these understandings that we now take as gospel truths. This inspired my next set of works, which I call Seven Elements, and this explored, you know, the changes, the transformations that we go through life, and I expressed this using seven elemental forces. I went back to the whole idea of a personal mythology. Okay, I have two sets of works in this. One that represents my youth, and my youth basically is characterized by rage. You know, I had a lot of anger issues, so I wasn't a very happy kid. You know, sorry about that. But so from rage, you know, how have I changed as a person, and where do I want to go towards? And so I set the end chapter of my life in a scenario that is characterized by equanimity. You know, where you are more accepting of things. And so, what happens between these two, you know, that is a big question. That is something that I'm leaving open for me to sort of write or rewrite, or, you know, come up with in future works. I took the opportunity to interrogate the mythology of New York, and this is a series entitled City and the City. And here, I posit an alternative reality to the New York that we are all familiar with. And this, in this reality, New York is a global nexus of spirituality rather than you know, the center or the epitome of the materialistic, capitalistic perspective that we've all that we're also familiar with. So one of the issues when you think about transformation is transience, and that nothing is permanent, the whole idea that nothing is permanent. And here I, here I have kind of like represented in my works, you know, using, you know, certain symbols that represent transience, be it flowers, you know, be it fallen godheads, whether it's a bodhisattva's, you know, left of a bodhisattva statue, or, you know, an Ultraman, you know, which we as kids were really into. Also, when I look back at my works, I realize that, you know, I include a lot of trickster figures. So, you know, you find, you know, characters like Loki, who else, Hermes from Greek mythology, you know, monkey god from Chinese mythology, and the fox spirit from Chinese, Japanese, Korean mythologies as well. So, you know, characters like these, they are tricksters, and I include a lot of tricksters in my work because for me they represent agents of change. They are the forces of change. Death for me is also something that's a very, very big thing. It's you know, an issue that you know, I keep thinking about, because death, whether existential or metaphorical, brings about changes. And you know, if things were to remain static all the time, there would be no death, there would be no change. So a lot of these things that you see here, whether it's the scene of an accident, of a bus accident, or whether it's, you know, Kabir's hookahs and gates of hell, or you know, this very threatening Babylonian-like wolf creature here, they all represent some sort of threat. So they could be metaphorical, they could be existential, but, you know, they represent the possibility of death and the big unknown that we face every day of our lives. I do not have a fixed idea of who I am. You know, who I am from changes from one moment to the other is quite contextual. And so I find it quite you know, suitable that, you know, I'm kind of like drawing on sort of the Hindu concept of the godhood, where, you know, God, there is one God, but he has all these different manifestations. You know, you could be Shiva or Brahma, or it could be Krishna, or it could be anything else. And you know, even the goddesses are also just expressions of that single godhead. So, you know, and nowadays, you know, these days, we going online, we have all these online personas and avatars, and that's kind of how I kind of like express myself in my works. And so, you know, sometimes when you see this, really weird characters in my works, just bear in mind that these are representations of me. Okay, I have this suspicion that, you know, all of us are looking for something bigger in life. And what we all yearn towards is a state of transcendence. You know, however we define transcendence, it is a personal thing, but I think that universally as people, you know, it's something that we all yearn towards. We want to be connected to something that's bigger than ourselves. And this is something that also I've also kind of like worked into my my paintings. You notice, well, you know, a lot of what influences me stems from the Buddhist and Taoist philosophy. the whole idea that nothing is permanent, and you know, the whole idea that everything is in flux. And that paired with, you know, my readings of mythology when I was a kid, you know, Greek mythology, Egyptian, Norse mythology, plus being brought up with folk tales from Chinese, Indian, and Malay culture, you know, those kind of things really interested me as a kid, because, you know, it's like here I am living this very ordinary life, you know, being angry most of the time with, you know, things that were happening to me, things that I see going on in the world, and they offered a way of looking beyond the reality, the mundaneness of reality, and, you know, in a way, the pain of, you know, what we have right now, and they offered an alternative world. They offered another way of looking at the world that was bigger and perhaps better than what we have right here. People believe in spirits, people, you know, believe in gods, and these are things that are incorporated into the fabric of life back home in Singapore and in a large part of Asia. So for us, a lot of these things are not exotic, they are very everyday. And you know, for me, you know, looking at the world in a sort of using a mythological framework is not something that is completely exotic to me. It is quite a natural way of perceiving things. I grew up on lots and lots of cartoons, maybe a bit too much, and I think that I'm still in that state. So we had you know, a lot of this kind of fantasy shows of, you know, that appealed to children from the West as well as from the East. So, you know, a lot of this visual language that I grew up with, you know, are things that I carry forward in my work. Cartoons, anime, I grew up with a lot of sci-fi and comics as well. And this informs how I actually approach my works. I always think of my series in terms of story arcs. And, you know, when we create mythologies, we also create possible worlds, you know, possibilities, alternatives of looking at the world, of looking at reality. I also do lots of research, and this particularly is forms some of the research that I did when I was working on the City and the City series. You know, when I first came to New York, I think it was a time when there were many exhibitions going on in different museums that focused on Native American cultures. And I think that it could be a matter of, you know, coincidence, but, you know, I saw that as a sign that, you know, this could be a key into how I, you know, would approach my work in New York. And what I did was that, apart from looking at the material artifacts of the indigenous tribes, I also did readings on Native American theology, or as far as, you know, what could be interpreted as a Native American theology. One of the strategies that I use in my work also is a lot of layering, and because I do not see life in black and white, it's hard for me to say, okay, you know, there's this thing that happened, you know, A, you know, slap B, and this is just, and that's because B pissed A off. And I would be thinking, oh no, but what if this were to, if this was what led this situation to happen? So, you know, I have probably too complex a mind, I can't, you know, commit myself to a single answer. So I always think of all these possible answers, and in a way, it makes my life a lot more difficult. But I think that it also makes my art a lot more interesting, at least for me. I don't know about you, but at least for me. I like to layer all these meanings. I like to layer the things that I kind of, like, you know, am influenced by and bring into a single piece of work. And I think that what this also does is that it allows you, the viewer, multiple readings and, you know, multiple interpretations and even misinterpretations. And I think that that's much more fun than you know, having the artist giving his so-called authoritative view on what the work should be.
It's very nice of Ren Zi to prepare these materials for you to explain the background of his work. As you can see, he's an avid researcher. These days, it's also a characteristic of contemporary artists who's doing a lot of reading and research. You know, sometimes you call somebody a research scientist, right? But then in the milieu of contemporary artists, especially from Asia, we call them research artists. They actually, you know, spend a lot of time, you know, doing background research and pondering on. Ren Zi is especially very erudite type of contemporary artist. You know, even though his works are loaded with his symbolic motifs and meanings, I'd like to draw your attention to his installation piece. Did you see his installation? Behind the, you know, the plexiglass and empty desk with one notebook, and you may wonder if Ren Zi's work usually have a lot of imagery, but why this is actually devoid of any symbols or images. So there are some stories behind it. So let's listen to Ren Zi.
I think that in terms of the formalistic quality of art, I'm kind of like torn between two sensibilities. One is the Qing Dynasty style of you know, loading a lot of elements into your work, and that leaves, gives rise to something that is visually richer. The other part of me likes to pile on everything, which is almost kind of like very soaring in its sensibility. Mimosine 4, number 4, which is the installation piece here, is actually a new approach to art making that I'm trying out. And it focuses on using items with a lot of personal memories attached to them. They're very emotionally loaded. And sort of finding ways of you know, sealing them away from the external environment, you know, and you know, using both physical means, whether it's, you know, putting them behind a glass wall, or, you know, more occult means, which is, you know, to put up talismans and seals that symbolically keep the sort of the emotional spirit or the emotional associations with them within the enclosure of the work. So Mimosine 4 is actually it actually has a few components to it, and you know, there's supposed to be music playing from the laptop. There is also supposed to be a projection that is you know, that's been screened on the wall behind you, but you're not really able to hear the music or to see the image, which is kind of like, you know, because of the lighting, because of the ambient light and the ambient sound. Because these are things, these are spirits that are supposed to be sealed within the room. And, you know, it's only through much difficulty, if you really strain your ears or you strain your eyes, that you'll be able to glimpse some of these elements. So, this set of work essentially sits as a counterpoint to my more mythographic works, because a lot of the objects that I use for the Mimosine series are things that affects in my life or have effects in my life, and whether, you know, the fact that I cannot deny, I cannot edit this works the way that I do with my more mythographic works, you know, it sits as a sort of counterpoint to, you know, my practice. And I think that this, for me, creates a nice tension. And I think that I need that tension to keep myself on my toes, at least artistically.
So what is the music being played? It's a sort of a random, you know, sort of sound, or is it a song, or what is it?
Well, actually, the music played comes from a collection from a friend who passed away, and The installation work is actually an installation that is dynamic, and in time I'll be putting up books and CDs, which I actually have inherited from him after he passed away. So the music that's being played on the iBook actually is a sort of a playlist from his collection.
It's existing songs, it's like a popular songs that he used to like.
A lot of alternative, a lot of rock.
And then, you know, as an artist or as a creator, we can actually hear about his work process. Like when you layer these images, do you have like a central point that you start with, or as you experiment with layouts, you know, your ideas keep changing, or what is your work method in terms of laying these images? I mean, you are a media art artist, so I assume that you create image using, you know, your media software, and then you manipulate on the computer screen, and then once you decide on, you put the colors, and then, you know, you can print out on any medium, right? That's the advantage of being a media artist. But if you can tell us a little bit about how your thinking process or work process is like, that would be really interesting.
Well, I work in different ways, and you know, I don't really have one specific A to Z way of you know, of coming to a finished piece of work. I think that, as I mentioned, when I first started the series, I think in terms of an arc. What is the series going to be? You know, what is the narrative in this series? And then I would then kind of like spec out the possible things that I can say about within the series, and then I'll select which are the ones that would you know, be most resonant for me personally, and then work out you know, in terms of the aesthetics, in terms of the elements that go into it, you know, what could I bring together that could, you know, bring out the meaning, or, you know, add a different layer, a richness to the work. Sometimes I would do little, you know, pencil sketches, little thumbnails on pieces of paper, usually scrap paper, so I don't feel so precious about the work. And sometimes I jump straight to sketching on the computer. So I use two very, very basic programs, Illustrator and Photoshop. And for me, these are just means to an end. I'm not really interested in learning every single technique available in these programs, though they are very powerful programs. What is more important for me is the concept of the works. So a lot of times, while I start off with a basic idea of how the work is going to be and how it's going to come out at the end, I also leave myself a lot of room for spontaneity, for changes, and that makes the process a lot more fun, rather than detecting something that you know would come out in a certain way in the end, although there have been times when that has happened. So.
So as a Singaporean artist, you know, you grew up in a very dynamic and diverse cultural background, but you also spent 3 months in New York City during your residency program. So what would be your impression or your thought on, what can I say, multi-ethnic society of the U.S. As you experience in New York City? I mean, you know, the cityscape, or, you know, the types of people that you run across, or, you know, the kind of advertisement or public art imageries on the city, you know, all together, you know, what's your reflections on the diverse cultures of New York or the U.S.? What do you think?
I get a sense that New York is not the rest of America. and in a way, why I feel more at home in New York is probably because it's of its, you know, diversity in terms of ethnicities and, you know, religious creeds. And you know, Singapore is what I call a cultural singularity, where you have the major cultures in Asia, East Asia, South Asia, Southeast Asia, kind of like crammed into a piece of land that is no bigger than 40 kilometers across and 20 kilometers north-south. So it's really much smaller than the five boroughs of New York put together. And what I find, that is why I kind of like feel at home here. But the difference between Singapore and New York is that New York represents more of the world. You have people from different continents, not just from a part of the world. And that adds to its vibrance, and I think that's why we all love the city so much. It isn't my first time here. I have good friends who live here or who are based here. So in a way, it is a little bit like a second home, especially lived here for the few months that I have and making friends here. I think that people do make the difference.
I also know that you write a lot too, like for your own artwork. I mean, if you go to the gallery, there is like a little plaque, with the descriptions or some reflections on your own artwork. So, how do you perceive yourself? Like, a writing process is as important as visual creation for you. I mean, that's also part of the new contemporary art. I mean, these days artists become sort of prolific writers at the same time. So, what your trier or what your try on covering both genre of artistic skills.
Well, I'm kind of like I have very mixed reactions to that. I thought that I came to art to escape writing, just as when I went into advertising as a copywriter, I went to it to escape art. So, but having to write the text for the City in the City series was something that was inevitable because. For this series, I actually took a more anthropological approach to it. And here we are, here I am positing the possibility of this alternative universe. And what if we, in this reality, were able to access this other reality and, or at least the people who are able to access it, went there and came back and they had to tell the rest of us here what it's like over there. So, the writing is very much, the text is very much a part of the work. There is a part of me that can never run away from the narrative aspect of it. The fact that, I love reading. But at the same time, I also think visually. Like when I was a writer in advertising, I was thinking of my ideas visually. While my partner, who is the art director, he would think of the ideas in words. So that's kind of like really, really screwed up. But I think that, there is no running away from bringing together word and image. And the fact that we now acknowledge that they complement each other, they don't necessarily detract from each other, is one of the good things that's happening in art these days, that boundaries are breaking down. What is high art, lowbrow art can be just as beautiful and arresting as so-called conceptual art. Street art is being seen in galleries these days, design, commercial art, there is a certain, there are conceptual underpinnings to these as well, so it's not just in the realm of fine art or contemporary fine art that, we can explore all the issues that, contemporary fine art, purports itself to, you know, to focus on. You know, it's being explored in every single discipline where that's creative.
In relation to the blurring boundaries, you know, Ren Zi, you know, became artist sort of late in his life, and unlike other Asian artists, especially in Japan and Korea, students are like aspiring artists. They start their training very early, and they go through fine arts programs, and they go to master's program. But in your case, you somehow became a self-taught artist. And do you think this, you know, like accidentally landing on, you know, visual artist career, do you think that it actually liberated you from being more adventurous and more like a speculative? And, you know, did it give you like a more liberty in a way? I mean, what's your reflections on that?
Well, I guess that, you know, in becoming an artist, I didn't feel that I have a choice. I've been trying to run away from art and I've been trying to be practical most of my life. Well, I do not come from a well-to-do family, so one of my my main obligation as a filial son is to provide for my folks. So, you know, going to advertising, being a writer was an efficient way of making a pretty decent living. I guess that art found me. You know, I was at a point where, you know, I needed to, you know, resolve certain issues, art was a way of helping me work through those issues. Choosing to become an artist full time, or at least more full time. You know, that was something that was completely serendipitous. And, you know, it's interesting that a lot, or at least a number of my people that I know in Singapore, they're making that mid-career change into art. And, you know, you have people who used to be lawyers, who used to, work in the production industry, and, you know, they're venturing into fine art. So I find that interesting, and, you know, it's like, yeah, you have a group of people who very fortunately were able or are able to start their art career early on, who have the very clear vision of, you know, that they want to be artists, and this is what they have chosen for their life's work. And there are us, this other group, who have only found a calling mid life. So I don't think that either way is good or bad. It's just the way, you know, life turns out for us. You know, the way that, you know, life will turn out for a lot of you, you know, young people here. You know, you'll find lots of strange twists and turns, and, you know, you never know where you end up. So, you know, you may think that you end up at point C right now, but end up at point D or E instead. I think that's one of the more interesting things in life, is that you cannot predict it.
I mean, I think you are so fortunate that you found your true calling. I mean, having taught in art schools for more than 10 years, many students of mine actually come up to me and they say, I realize that I am not suitable for being a full-time artist. And then after graduating from fine arts program, they actually choose a different degree and they actually do very well. But you know, you came the other way around, and I think that's your strength. Like, your artworks are full of very thoughtful ideas and reflections on life and culture. And you know, that's only possible because you lived your life and then you came, you know, now. In terms of your sort of maintaining your artistic career as a media artist, how many editions would you usually allow yourself to print? For example, print makers or printing artists, they only send like 20 copies of one edition at a time, or you know, they do they make a lot of effort, right, to have a certain control over their work. But what's your ideas on those side of artists, being artists?
One side of me wants to be really democratic and, you know, disseminate my work, you know, sort of unlimited. But, you know, art also is an industry and it is a commodity. And the scarcity of it is what gives it value in the eyes of many people, in the eyes of institutions and collectors. So, in a way, a lot of my works, especially this one here, this series here, give me a sec, guys. Okay. This series here, and this one here, they're unique pieces. The pebble works that you see in the exhibition, they're editions of 6 with 2 APs. The light boxes, they are editions of 3 with 1 AP.
You have to archive your work because your original work comes in the form of like a digital file, right? So what kind of effort do you make in order to preserve it? I mean, that's a big concern in terms of media art these days. You know, video artists from the 80s, actually, there's no VHS, videotapes anymore. Or if you think about Nam June Pang on video art, we don't have that tube television set anymore, right? So, there are like these pressing issues, how to come up, keep up with technology or how to preserve your work. For example, this kind of software that you are using, for this work, it's only meaningful in that 2014 and 15, but how are you going to preserve it for the, let's say, 2050 or 70? So, what's your plan for this?
Okay, I guess that I have to be very, very practical here. And, the whole issue that video files or certain works are becoming obsolete because technology is not available to present them is a very big issue in media art. And so when I started choosing, to work digitally, one of the things I was thinking of is if I were to present my works digitally, would I want to be very specific in the way I present it? And let's say if I say, okay, I want my works to present it only using a cathode ray tube television set, or would I be flexible enough to allow it to be translated into other formats, other digital formats, and other presentation styles, and thereby, giving it longevity in that sense, and not handcuffing it to a particular technology. So, I think that for me, as long as the concept of the work, the soul, the essence of the work is preserved, that is all that matters. In terms of the other works that take physical form, the big issue would be how will you preserve your files? While the works will not be reproduced ever again, you still would like to keep an archive of it. And so I think the big issue is whether future versions of a particular software will be able to read the older versions of software, so you hope that that compatibility is something that future developers preserve in whatever it is they're working on. But that is one issue, and the other issue is that in the storage, making sure that your files, they keep replicating your files and storing them sensibly, so that they do not become corrupted, that you lose as little as possible. I think that losing the purity of your digital files is inevitable because technology is not perfect. Nothing in this world is perfect. So we have to be prepared to lose your, be prepared to lose your files at a certain point. But in as far as you can, you know, or at least as far as I can, you know, I try to make sure that my files are properly archived and, you know, stored, and then I build in redundancies.
Answer for this, but now you know it's over. You know, coming to an end. So if you, any of you, have a question to Ren Zi, this is time to direct it. Yes.
I did some research before the lecture, and I saw on a website called The Artling. It said that a lot of your work was like open-ended stories. Do you agree with that?
I think that they're open-ended in a way. That you, how in terms of the interpretations, you know, I would like to keep them open ended. You know, how you read my work will be very different from how the lady behind you reads it or how I read it. And I kind of like think of my works almost like Mustache projective test. It's like you would project what already is in your reality onto the works as you would with anything else, with it. You would do the same with a film. So I kind of like see that as a sort of window to people's minds when they go, oh, you know, this, I don't see this as an image of them. I see this as an image of rebirth. And I go, well, good on you. You're very optimistic.
Okay, so anybody else? I mean, it became quite a small audience. So instead of us staying on the stage, you know, talking to you, actually we end this session and then we actually mingle, and you know, you can, you know, come up and talk to Ren Zi during, you know, during the duration of time, and you know, he also wants to talk to you, where you are coming from, which background. So thank you so much for attending this session, and thank you so much for coming all the way from Singapore for this exhibition, opening an exhibition. And it's my pleasure to get to know Ren Zi. And thank you so much.
Thank you.